Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, Echoes of Grace. That was, again, another beautiful song that was delivered to us. You guys doing great this evening? Very good. You know, tonight, we're going to continue with what we've been studying last night. So basically, we're going to talk about the seven seals. So we're still with seven seals. And last night, we talked about first, second, third, fourth, and fifth seals. But tonight, we're going to talk about the sixth seal. And then we're going to talk about the second coming, which is part of the seventh seal. So to begin with, Revelation chapter 6, verse 12, the Bible says, "And I beheld when he had opened the what? Sixth seal, and lo, there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became as blood." Now, in the Bible, here we have God is telling us a great sign. And this great sign happens to be great earthquake. So, but there are many earthquakes that took place, right? Throughout all generations, throughout all history, we have many different earthquakes. Then how are we supposed to know which one this is talking about? Well, if we go back to the seven seals that we talked about, the first seal is really describing what happened to the Christian movement in the first century. And the second seal is describing what happened in the time of Roman Empire persecuting the Christians. And the third seal is describing a time when the Christians and the pagans were compromising. So we're basically looking at the fourth century. And then the fourth seal, it is talking about death. It is really talking about the Great Tribulation, the time when many, many Christians were persecuted. Now, because last night we didn't have that much time to go into details, but the fourth seal is really talking about persecution not from the unbelievers, persecution not from the pagans, not from the heathen so much, but we're talking about Christians persecuting Christians. And that's exactly what happened during the era that we call it the Dark Age. The Dark Age. And Dark Age lasted for a long, long time. It was about around 1,000 years plus. Okay? And the Dark Age time began to die out during the 15th and the 16th century. So when we come to the fifth seal, we're talking about a time when God's people were crying out, and even though it was a symbolic language that we saw last night, but fifth seal is indicating that after the great persecution against the Christians, the time has come for God's people are asking for God to do something to bring forth judgment and avenge. And then we have the sixth seal. So based upon the timeline, we're looking at the sixth seal happens around 16th century and 17th century. So then the question is this. Around 17th century, did we have any major earthquake around that time? Well, believe it or not, when we go back to the history, back in 1755, Lisbon earthquake. Have you heard about this earthquake before? Yeah, it was really, really terrible. Now, according to the record, it says that the magnitude in range of 8.5 to 9.0. That was a major, major earthquake. And according to the record, estimates places the death toll in Lisbon alone between 10,000 to 100,000 people, is making it the one of the deadliest earthquake in history. So when we talk about Lisbon earthquake, as far as we can see, based upon the record that we have in history, this was the worst earthquake of all. And interesting enough, this earthquake took place 1755, around the time when Fifth Seal ended and the Sixth Seal began. So it fits right into the prophecy when the Bible says there was a great earthquake. And this earthquake took place in Lisbon. It wasn't in China, it's not in Australia, it's not in New Zealand, it's not in Africa. It happened in Lisbon. Why? Where is Lisbon? Portugal. Where is Portugal? Europe. What are we talking about? You see, back in 1755, many of the Christians were still in Europe. So God gave that sign where many Christians were living. So it just makes perfect sense. So when, according to the Bible, when we see that earthquake, Lisbon earthquake, that is an indication that we're coming closer to the end time. But then it's not only the earthquake, the Bible says. It says great earthquake and the what? Sun became black as sackcloth of hair and the moon became as blood. So sun became black and moon became blood. Now this particular sign, according to the Bible, it looks as though happens after the great earthquake. And do we have anything like that in the history? Yes, we do. I don't know if you can read this or not, but in 1780, all right? 1780, May 19, in New England area, they had what they call the dark day. In the morning, it was like any other day. Sun was up, chickens were crying, cows were in the pasture, in the field, but then suddenly, it just became dark and darker and darker and darker. At noon, it was so dark, they had to have a lantern, a light to shine their path to be able to find their ways. The animals were coming back to the barn. The birds were, they're becoming silent because they thought the night has fallen. It was amazing. It was recorded in the history as the dark day. And far as we know, there was no such a day like that before and since then, the dark day. And according to the history, at night when the moon came up, they said the moon looked as though it was covered with blood. Again, another fulfillment of the sign that the Bible mentions in the book of Revelation. And then the Bible says in Revelation chapter 6, verse 13, and the stars of heaven fell unto the earth, even as a fig tree casteth her untimely figs, when she is shaken of a mighty wind. So here we have the signs. Number one, great earthquake. Number two, sun and moon turning dark or turning blood, right? And then the final sign, stars falling. So do we have anything like that in history? So we're talking about after the Lisbon earthquake, 1755, after the dark day, 1780, after 1780, do we have any sign that happened where people witness falling stars? Now, how many of you have seen falling stars before? I'm sure you have, right? How many? Maybe one. Yeah, and when you see one star falling, you felt a little romantic, yes? Did you give your loved one a kiss or something? Or wish upon a star? Yeah, your true love will show up in the front door someday. But you only had one star. How many of you seen like two or three falling stars? If you have, you're really lucky, right? Now, This is what happened in history. In 1833, November 12 and 13, they had what they called a tempest of falling stars broke over the earth. And interesting enough, what's interesting is this. Do you remember the dark day? It says it happened around New England. Now, where is New England? New England, we're talking about America. Where? Northeast. New England, we're talking about Maine, we're talking about New York, New Hampshire, okay? All these places, Connecticut. Now, why the sign of a dark day happened in New England area? Interesting enough, around 1780, guess where many of the Christians were? New England, yes. So it's very interesting how God showed these signs where Christians are. First, in Europe, and then New England. And then these falling stars, you can see it definitely in New England area. You can see it definitely in Europe and many other places around the world. But especially in New England area, they were able to witness falling stars. Now, how many stars do you think they saw falling in one night? It says that 240,000 stars must have been visible during the 9 hours they continued to fall. How many hours? 9 hours. Can you imagine? 9 hours stars are falling. And according to one historian, when stars fell, they all the stars do not fall in the same fashion. You know how some stars can fall this way, yes? Some stars fall this way, right? So they literally saw like a checkerboard in the sky. Shoom, 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 shoom. Can you imagine for 9 hours? Yeah? So if you're living those times, if you're living in those days, what would you think? Oh, great earthquake in Lisbon, 8.5, 9.0, a major, thousands of people died. And then, around 35 years later, the dark day, cannot explain. They cannot explain, but it fulfills exactly what the Bible says. And then, around 40 years later, 1833, falling stars. That is the reason why, my friends, during that time, many Christians from Methodist, Congregation, Presbyterian, Pentecostal, Baptist, many different Christians, they came together to study the Bible because they believed that Jesus is coming back soon. And they had what they called Advent movement, a movement among Christians believing that Jesus is coming very soon. Let me tell you something. These signs already happened more than 150 years ago. But let me tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. If they felt like Jesus coming soon, what about us today? Jesus is really coming soon. Because here's the reason why. In the Bible, gives us these signs, especially sun, moon, and stars. And you can read this in the book of Luke, chapter 21. And verse 25, Jesus said, there shall be what? Signs in the sun, and in the moon, and in the stars. See that? So Jesus saying, you will see these signs, but after this, these signs you will see upon the earth distress of nations, with perplexity, the sea and the waves roaring, man's heart failing them for fear, and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. For the powers of heaven shall be shaken, and then they shall see the what? Son of Man coming. So according to the words of Jesus, according to the book of Revelation, after you see the signs in the sun, in the moon, in the stars, you can really expect that Jesus is going to come very soon. And let me tell you something. We are a lot closer to the second coming than ever before, ladies and gentlemen, because the earth is about to come to its end. How long do you think this earth will continue in this suffering, in this pain, in this pollution? Let me tell you something. We may be busy trying to survive, but there are a lot of things happening around the world that are telling us that Jesus is coming soon. What do you say? Amen? Or maybe you like this world. Oh, maybe you love Bacolo so much, you don't want Jesus to come back, huh? Is that what you're thinking? Now, I like Bacolo too. I love your coconut water drink. I love your wind. I love your sunshine. I love your smiles. I love this place. But let me tell you something. Heaven will be better than here. Amen? Heaven will be better than Korea. So we are even. Amen? Okay. So that's what we're waiting for, ladies and gentlemen. The kingdom of God. And these signs are telling us that Jesus is coming back soon. And then we go back to Revelation chapter 6, verse 14. The Bible says, and the heaven departed as a what? Scroll, when it is rolled together, and every mountain and island were what? Move out of their places. Now, when you read that, what is this talking about? You see, my friends, this particular sign, mountains are moved, islands are removed. These signs will happen just right before at the time when Jesus is coming. Okay? But some of you, like, you look a little worried because Philippines is full of islands. Do you worry? Do you worry about that? Because the Bible says islands were moved out of their places. You know, I believe islands will be moved out of their places at the time when Jesus comes. But listen, don't worry. You can continue to live in Philippines unless you want to move to Canada. Unless we want to move to Australia or America. But listen, if you are a child of God, God will protect you. What do you say? Amen. Amen? Now, that does not mean you should build your house right next to a volcano. So don't be presumptuous. However, as long as you're doing all that you can to be safe and spreading the gospel, sharing the good news to others, you are a child of God, God will protect you. However, the Bible does give us really terrifying imagery of what will happen the very end of time. So, after this, what do we have? The Bible actually has the description of the second coming of Jesus Christ. It says, and the kings of the earth, and the great men, and the rich men, and the chief captains, and the mighty men, every bondman, every free man. Wow, that sounds like everybody. Pay attention, all right? Kings and the great men, the rich men, captains, bondmen. What is bondmen? Slaves. Free men. Mighty men. So what is the Bible trying to say? In the last days, ladies and gentlemen, I am so sorry to tell you this, but according to the Bible, I have to tell you what the Bible says. Amen? The Bible says many people are going to be lost. And for some reason, God decided to mention many men in many different possessions. So, that does not mean if you're a great man, rich man, captain, or kings, that doesn't mean you automatically will be lost. No. But the Bible is saying, gives us the idea that a lot of these people, you know, they could have been saved. However, they refused to accept Jesus. They refuse to surrender their heart to Him because they love their possession, their reputation, a lot more than Jesus. Just like Pilate. Pilate, you remember Pilate, the story of Pilate? Jesus was standing before Pilate, and Pilate had the power to release Jesus, let Him go free, right? But Pilate, he didn't want to do that. Why? Because if he did that, then the Jewish leaders will send a false report to Caesar, saying Pilate is not a friend to Caesar. So Pilate, he wanted to keep his position, so he complied, he compromised, and he go along with the wrong wishes of the Jewish leaders. Can you imagine? He had the power and opportunity to let Jesus go. But ladies and gentlemen, in the same and like manner, many people in the last days, I know, So ladies and gentlemen, this is what you got. You need to have this kind of mindset. It's okay to be rich? No problem. Abraham was rich. Nicodemus was rich. No problem. It's okay to be a great man? Praise God. Be a great man by God's grace and His leading. Can you be a king? If you want to be a king, go right ahead. All right. Can you be a chief captain? You want to be chief captain? Go right ahead. However, when you have those possessions, right? Just keep in your mind, that is not your number one position. That is not your full-time work. Your full-time work is for God. Even though you may not give, even though you may not be able to do God's work full, literal time, however, kingdom of God always comes first. What do you say, ladies and gentlemen? Amen? So don't be like these people. And what are they doing when Jesus comes back? The Bible says what? Hid themselves in the dens, in the rocks of the mountains. So why are these people hiding when Jesus is coming? Why are they hiding when Jesus is coming? Let me ask you something. Are you planning to hide from Jesus when Jesus comes back? Are you? I hope not. Because the Bible says, and said to the mountains and rocks, these people, fall on us and hide us from the face of Him that sitteth on the throne and from the what? Wrath of the Lamb. Wrath of the Lamb? Wrath? What is another word for wrath? Anger. Anger of the Lamb? Huh? Do you guys have sheep in Philippines? Goats and sheep, yeah? When was the last time you saw a lamb getting angry and barking at you? I don't know. I don't know how they do it, but do you see lamb or sheep getting angry? No, then what is this? Wrath of the Lamb. Do you think Jesus, when Jesus come back, He's going to have a lamb-like face but angry face at the same time? Soft, woolly face, but like angry? That sounds creepy, right? No. What is it talking about? No, you see, when Jesus comes back, He's going to come back with always that glorious, majestic, lovely face. Always lovely. Not in anger. But to the wicked, they, when they see Jesus, it is as though anger. Why? Because their life is completely contrary, opposite to the life of Jesus. And you may experience something like that sometimes. When you know that you're living not a good life, and when you stand right next to someone that really is dedicated, you know, really a genuine Christian, how do you feel? You feel a little what? A little poking, guilty, right? A little uncomfortable. Come on. Yes? Yes? Can you imagine if you feel a little uncomfortable with human being who is dedicated and who sinned before? Can you imagine how you're going to feel to stand before God, before Jesus, when you don't have His Spirit in you? That's why, according to the Bible, to them, Jesus will be looked upon as though He is angry. And what are they doing? What are they asking? What is their final wish? Hide us. Why are they hiding when Jesus is coming back? Let me ask you something. In the Bible, when was the first time men ever hid from God? In the Garden of Eden. Let me show you. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife did what? Hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst trees of the garden. So tell me from the Bible, from the beginning of Genesis, okay, chapter 3, what was the reason why Adam and Eve, they hid themselves from God? Because they what? Sin. So, in the last days, when Jesus come and all these kings and the chief men, great men, rich men, bond men, free men, when they're hiding from Jesus, why? Because, ladies and gentlemen, because they sinned. It's not only they sinned, you see, we all sinned. But they decide to keep their sin. Keep their sin. They did not want to confess. They did not want to repent. They don't want Jesus to apply His blood to forgive them. They want to cherish, nurture, maintain in their sin. So, Book of Revelation is telling us, if we continue to hold on to sin, and you know that God is saying, give that up, according to the Bible, you are planning to hide from Jesus. So, if you hide your sin in your heart, you're going to hide from Jesus. But if you open your sin to Jesus, let Jesus forgive and wash away and change you, then you can see Jesus with open face. What do you say? Amen? Is that clear? Very important, ladies and gentlemen, because the Bible says, for the great day of His wrath is come. Who shall be able to? I'm glad that this question is already recorded in the Bible for us to read, for us to think about the answer today. Don't wait until when Jesus come to have that question and then to answer at that time. No, no, no. We need to answer this question today. So God is telling us, who shall be able to stand? That's the greatest question in the Bible. When Jesus comes back, who shall be able to stand in the presence of the Holy God? So ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, there are going to be only two types of people in the last days when Jesus comes back. Who are they? One group, hiding. Other group, standing. Is that clear? Is that clear? So listen. We already have the signs, the earthquake. We already have the sign, the sun and moon. We already have sign, the stars. Jesus is coming back soon. Let's get ready. But let's go a little deeper into this question. The Bible does ask the question, who shall be able to stand? And the Bible gives us the answer. Matter of fact, the answer is found the very next text, which is the next chapter, verse 1, 2, 3, and 4. All right, so let's read those verses. So we go to chapter 7, verse 1. This verse is mentioned right after the question, who shall be able to stand? So the Bible is giving us the answer, but let's read it. And it says, after these things I saw how many angels? Four angels standing on the what? Four corners of the earth, holding the what? Four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, nor on the sea, nor on any tree. Ah, here's a text that has four, four, four. Four angels standing on the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth. Now, what is happening over here? Do you think this is literal? Like angels are like holding back the wind, perhaps. But at the same time, is a symbolic expression. What expression? They're holding back the wind. What kind of wind is this? All right then, in the Bible, especially Bible prophecy, what do those winds represent? Okay? Because they're holding back. By the way, this wind, the Bible says four winds of the earth. What does that mean? It's a worldwide what? Wind. That's what it means. Worldwide, international, universal wind. Or something's going to, the wind will blow around the earth, the whole world. Okay, then, what does wind represent? Well, let's find out. In Proverbs chapter 1, verse 27, the Bible says, when your fear cometh as desolation, and your what? Destruction cometh as a whirlwind. So there you go. Wind in the Bible represents destruction. So when the Bible says four winds of the earth, we're talking about four destructions that will come upon the earth. Just basically saying the earth is about to be destroyed. However, the earth is about to be destroyed. However, the angels are what? Holding back. Angels are holding back. And ladies and gentlemen, because they're holding back the winds today, we have peaceful day. Our weather is good. We're still surviving. Yes, I'm telling you. But we do not know when those winds will be let go. But there's a reason why the angels are holding back. Why are they holding back the winds? Now, what is interesting is this. It says, winds of the earth, the wind should not blow on the earth, nor the what? Sea or water. In the Bible, sea or water represents, and he said unto me, the waters which thou sawest are people, multitude, nations, and tongues. So you get the picture here. Four winds, worldwide destruction about to come upon the multitude, nations, tongue, and people. You see? But the angels are holding back. They're holding back. And then the Bible says in verse 2, and I saw another angel. So imagine four angels are holding back the wind, the winds, and then this one angel coming, the Bible says, ascending from the east, having the what? Seal of the living God. Having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels, to whom it was given to hurt the earth and the sea. Now, so imagine this angel coming from the east, and this angel has what? The seal of the living God. And this angel, I don't have the Bible text here with me, but this angel says, don't let go the wind until we have sealed the servants of our God in their forehead with the seal of the living God. So don't let go the wind until I seal the servants of God in their forehead. Which means when the work of the sealing is done, guess what that means? The wind can be what? Let loose. Exactly. So the final work before the final destruction is, one of them is sealing for God's people. What is a seal for? What is that for? Ladies and gentlemen, this seal is very similar to what happened to the Israelites when they were coming out of Egypt. You remember the story? When they were coming out of Egypt, do you remember the plagues were coming down? But there was that one particular plague, they have to put a sign on their door. You remember the story? They have to put the blood of the lamb on the doorpost, right? And that was, it's like a seal. Why? What is a seal? What do you usually have in a seal? Back in those days, my friends, the Old Testament or the Bible time, those people, when they use seal, you know what it is? Signature, yes? Basically, that's what it is. So whose name do you think is on the signature in the seal? Seal of the living God. So basically, this is what it looks like. The angel says, don't let go the wind until we put the seal of the living God in the servants of God in their forehead. What does that mean when you have the seal of the living God? What does that mean? That means you belong to who? God, exactly. So pop, 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 pop. And when that work is done, God says, let the wind go. And only those who have the seal of the living God will be protected. Other people who refuse to receive the seal of the living God, in fact, according to the Bible prophecy, they receive something else. According to Revelation chapter 13, they receive the mark of the beast in their forehead. So in the last days, you only have two choices. As we come to the very end of time, you only have two choices. The seal of the living God in your forehead, or the mark of the beast in your forehead. So this is what's happening right here. So it is very important for us to understand what is the seal of the living God. What is it? What is it? Now, for us to understand this, we need to consider what kind of God is a living God. For us to understand what the seal is, because it is the seal of the living God, we have to understand what kind of God is a living God. So let's find that from the Bible. In Deuteronomy chapter 5, verse 26, the Bible says this. By the way, Deuteronomy chapter 5. Now, when you think of Ten Commandments, you're thinking of Exodus chapter 20. But Ten Commandments mentioned again here in Deuteronomy chapter 5. So in the same chapter, the Bible says, "For who is there of all flesh that has heard the voice of the what? Living God speaking out of the midst of the fire as we have and lived." So right there, the Bible describes God who gave the Ten Commandments from Mount Sinai out of the cloud with fire, remember? That God that gave the Ten Commandments, the Bible says, living God. All right then, let's do a little more study on the living God. According to Jeremiah chapter 10, verse 10, the Bible says, "But the Lord is the what? True God, He is the living God." So when we say living God, He is the what? True God. There are many counterfeit gods out there. No. Only true God is a living God. Because if you think about it, any other gods, they are not a living God. They are dead gods. Now, so what makes a living God a living God? Let's continue. "And an everlasting king, at his wrath the earth shall tremble, and nations shall not be able to abide his indignation. Thus shall he say unto them, the gods that have not what? Made the heavens and earth, even they shall perish from the earth, from under these heavens." So there is a big contrast. A major, major contrast. What contrast? There is a living God versus all other gods. What's the difference? All other gods that have not what? Made the heavens and earth. So what kind of God is a living God then? The opposite. Living God made heaven and earth. So when we say the seal of the living God, we're talking about seal of God who made heaven and earth. Another way of saying who made heaven and earth, one word. Creator, exactly. So when the Bible says seal of the living God, really this is talking about seal of the Creator. Are you following? So for some reason, listen, that is the only sign or only seal that makes it so clear who is the true God. How do we determine which God is true God? Only the Creator. Yes or no? If somebody comes to you, "I am God," and you ask the question, "Did somebody made you?" If the God says, "Yes," then that person is not God. It's that simple, okay? Were you made by somebody else? If you have, no, you are not a God. Okay, so let's confirm this. This happened when Paul and I believe Barnabas were preaching. It says, saying, "Sirs, why do ye these things? We also are men of like passions with you, and preach unto you that you should turn from these vanities." When the Bible says vanities, they're talking about idols, statues, okay, images, okay, idol worship. "Turn from these vanities unto the what? Living God, which made heaven and earth and the sea and all things that are therein." There you go. So you tell me from the Bible, not my opinion, not my ideas now, I'm showing you from the Bible, tell me what kind of God is a living God? Creator. Are you with me? So, before the winds let go, okay? If you want to be protected, you have to have what in your forehead? By the way, I know some translation that says on your forehead, but the correct translation is in your forehead. Please, please don't imagine in the last days somehow God will give us a nice heavenly tattoo on our forehead. Walking around, hey, I got the seal. No. We're talking about in the forehead, meaning in the mind. What does that mean? In the place where you have your thinking, your feeling, your decision, your willpower. Meaning your mind is committed to, when you receive the seal of the Creator, that means your mind is completely surrendered to the Creator. That's what it means. That means you are fixed. That means you are not going to change your mind. So, before God can put the seal of the living God, He needs to see you continue to live by faith. Not by your works. You cannot save yourself. Not by your own strength. No, don't do that. But continue to live by faith. And your faith has to be strong. What does that mean, strong? You are not going to change. Even though there are persecutors, even though you have a death threat, even though your life is not secure, but you continue to faithfully follow God. When God sees your faithfulness as you are living as a servant of God, not a servant to sin, God says, I am going to put the seal of the living God in their forehead. But then there's a little more detail regarding the seal of the living God. Why? Because this seal is directly connected to, listen, because it goes in the forehead, right? This seal is directly connected to, we accept God as our Creator. So is there anything in the Bible that speaks about how we accept God as a Creator? Is there anything? Interesting. In Romans chapter 4, verse 11, he received the what? Sign of circumcision, a seal of righteousness of faith. The reason why I'm showing you this Bible verse is that in the Bible, the word seal is same as sign. So the simple question is this. Where in the Bible that speaks about seal of God or sign of God that says, sign of God that shows that God is Creator? Are you with me? Where in the Bible that talks about that? Well, let's find out. Exodus chapter 31, verse 13, 3:1, 1:3, all right? Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily my what? Sabbath ye shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generation. So according to the Bible, what was a sign between God and His people? Sabbath. Now some of you might say, well, that was for the Jewish people. Actually, Sabbath, according to the Bible, it was given in Genesis, in the creation, for Adam and Eve. And Adam and Eve, they're not Jews. They're just first man and first woman. So it was God's plan that He wants His people, all the people on earth, to keep Sabbath from the creation. Okay, then what about Sabbath that is connected to Creator? Is it really Sabbath connected to Creator? Well, Ezekiel chapter 20, verse 20, the Bible says, and hallow my Sabbath, and they shall be a what? Sign between me and you, that you may know that I am the Lord your God. So then, when we have the seal of the living God, which is sign of the Creator, which is Sabbath, So when we have Sabbath in our forehead, you are acknowledging that the Lord is your God. Okay? Why is that? I know there's some people here tonight, you're thinking, well, I may not really keep Sabbath, but I believe that my Jesus, my Savior, is Creator. I understand what you're saying. But I want you to listen to this very carefully, because it gets a little more interesting than this. Okay? So, Acts chapter 14, verse 15. Living God is what kind of God? Which made heaven and earth and the seas and all things that are therein. Interesting. Then we discover that the sign of God, or the seal of the living God, is Sabbath. So when we go to the Sabbath commandment in Exodus chapter 20, verses 8 through 11, this is what we read. See, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the what? Seventh day is the what? Sabbath. Ladies and gentlemen, I know there might be some little discussion about this, but it is really, really super clear. Sabbath is the seventh day, and seventh day is Saturday. Yeah. You can look it up in the history book. You can look it up in catechism, in the teachings of Roman Catholic. They will tell you Sabbath is Saturday, but they changed to Sunday to show that the church has authority. Now, listen, I'm not here to bash or to talk just negative about the Catholic people. I have no desire to do that. However, I have this one desire. I just want to follow exactly what the Bible says. That's all. And when we do that, it looks as though God did not change Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday. And in fact, when we look at this, all right, it says the seventh day is a Sabbath, which is Saturday, Lord thy God. For in 6 days, the Lord what? Made heaven and earth, the seas and all that in them is. See that? Look at this. Seal of the what? Living God. And who is the living God? Which made heaven and earth, seas, all things therein. And then, where do we find that the God is the one that made heaven and earth? Sabbath. Lord made heaven, earth, and seas, and all that therein. See, same thing. So that is the reason why seal of the living God, or the sign of the Creator, is Sabbath. So then, let's summarize. Okay. The question is, who shall be able to stand? And then the picture is four angels holding back the four winds. Don't let go the wind until servants of God are sealed with the seal of the living God. Put it together. Who shall be able to stand, right? Who shall be able to stand? The answer is those who have seal of the living God, and the seal of the living God is Sabbath. Seal of the living God is Sabbath. So question, for the great day of his wrath is come, who shall be able to stand? The answer, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. See? And the seal of the living God is Sabbath. Now, you're probably thinking, are you telling me just because I've been keeping Sunday, I'm going to be lost? Well, I'm not here to pronounce the final judgment. But if you don't mind, just open your mind and your heart for a second. If you are a sincere Christian, and I believe that, you know, Adventist, Presbyterian, Baptist, Evangelical, Catholics, there are so many sincere people. I understand that. So loving people. Just because Adventists doesn't mean all Adventists are nice. Some of them are nasty, so be careful of them, okay? Okay, don't say all Adventists are like them. No. They need to repent, they need to change, and they need to have Jesus in their heart, amen? But I want to say, yes, there are a lot of good, sincere people, but ultimate question is this. What does the Bible say? according to the Bible, what is the teaching? Well, the teaching is, who shall be able to stand? The answer is, those who have the living God. And what is living God? Seal the living God? The Sabbath. So then you may think, is God that particular? Is God that so, I mean, for God is so important, like which day? I've been keeping Sunday as my Sabbath. So I choose. Okay. That sounds really nice, but you're a sincere Christian, right? Say yes. You want to follow exactly what the Bible says, right? Right? Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God, right? So if you want to live according to the word of God, so if you look for a places in the Bible that says Sunday is holy or God changed Sabbath, you are not going to find it. Let the Catholic priests tell you, there's no such Bible text. Where Sunday comes from? Tradition. Why is it there? There was a change. When pagans and Christians compromised during Constantine era, they changed Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday to accommodate the pagans who were already worshiping on Sunday. That's what happened, really. But you're thinking, but I'm not evil. I don't kill people. I don't steal. I just worship God on Sunday. What's wrong with that? It's only a day. Okay, you have a point there too. But let me show you something. I'm going to show you something that is, I'm going to let you judge. You guys are ready? I'm going to show you something. What was the very first problem? What was the very first problem that came to us? And where is it recorded? It's in Genesis, yes? Yeah, Genesis, right? Okay. The Bible says, now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Listen to the serpent. In fact, if you go into the Hebrew definition, the word serpent means enchanter. Enchantment. What does that mean, enchant? If you look up the word enchant in the basic root word, it means to sing. So I can easily imagine serpent didn't look like a snake. It was a beautiful animal, perhaps with wings. So serpent with a beautiful form, enchanter, sing with musical voice. Yea, has God said, ye shall not eat of every tree. I don't know what happened exactly. A little musical here today, right? A little musical. But it was a musical, lovely voice that God said, you should not eat of every tree of the garden. How many trees were there in the garden? There were what? A lot. Satan asked that question because he wanted Eve to think about the tree of the knowledge and good and evil. Yes? And God said, do not eat it, right? Lest he die. Listen to me very carefully. You cannot miss this point. You cannot miss this point. Listen. Let me ask you. That tree, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, how do you think it looked like? Do you think it looked as good as other trees? Or do you think this tree looked bad? What do you imagine? Do you think this tree was a black color? And branches coming down? And the sharp thorns are sticking out, and blood-like substance oozes out like a tree sap, and the fruit smells bad. Yeah? Do you imagine the tree of the knowledge of good and evil look like that? Huh? No! If it looked like that, God didn't have to say, don't eat this. Just looking at it, oh, I don't want that. Right? But the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, it looked good. It didn't look like this. I don't imagine it looked like this. You with me? It looked like perhaps this. It looks pleasant, nice color, maybe the fragrance, maybe it has some flowers, maybe the fruits are shiny. Yeah? Please don't say apple. I don't think it was an apple. Maybe durian, I'm just kidding. I don't think it was an apple nor durian. It was just a fruit. I'm sure it looked pleasant, beautiful, tall, you know, looks healthy, not harmful, right? And then the serpent's like, why do you think God said you cannot eat of every tree of the garden, including this one? And she's thinking, right? She's standing there. Why is she standing there? Let me ask you something. If you see an animal talking to you, what would you do? What would you do? I don't know what the ladies would do. Lady would scream and faint. And the guys would just jump back and kick. Right? Because we are afraid. Yeah? Here's Eve, you know, seeing this serpent talking. It's like he was not talking yesterday, but today he is talking. Yeah? And she didn't get scared. How do I know? The Bible doesn't say. And then Eve screamed, Adam, come here! The serpent is talking to me. No. She's standing there. She even said, I know what God said. God said, you should not eat it nor touch it, lest he die. She's like, I know what God said. But then she continued to stand there. If she really knew what God said, she should have said, I know what God said. Don't eat it, lest you die. Yes or no? Yeah? Yeah, that's how lady says no, like cold. Like a freezing cold. Yes? But she didn't do that. Why? She's like, I know what God said. Don't eat it and not even touch it, lest you die. But she's still standing there. Why? She's like, but I'm still curious. How come you can't speak to me? I'm really curious about this fruit. So look at this. At that point, based upon, listen, her senses, her sight, her hearing, her smell. I'm sure she can smell the fruit. And by the way, God never said, if you touch it, you will die. God only said, if you eat it, you will die. You understand? God never said, if you touch it, you will die. So I can easily imagine Satan, huh? God said, if you touch it, you will die? Well, and then maybe he dropped the fruit in her hand. Ah, you're touching it. Are you dying? Look at you. You're not dying. Why do you think I can speak to you? Yes, I ate the fruit. I became better. What God said is not true. You're touching it. You're hearing my voice. Smell the fruit. It's good. Are you with me? At that moment, all her senses, just about her sight, animal talking to her, hearing animal speaking to her, and maybe when she's so close, smell, she can almost taste, she's maybe feeling it. All the senses are saying, this fruit is okay to eat. And when we use senses, you know what we say? when we use our senses, this is scientific proof. You can see it, you can hear it, you can touch it. Scientific proof. So based upon her own scientific proof, fruit dangerous or safe? Safe. Based upon what she can see and hear and touch, right? But there's only one thing. Listen, there's only one thing that says that tree is not good to eat. It will kill you. What? What? Only one thing that says, do not eat that tree. If you eat it, you're going to die. What? What God said. At that time, what God said, it doesn't sound reasonable. What Satan was saying sounds logical, reasonable. So then, why God test Adam and Eve with that kind of temptation? When something looks so reasonable, harmless, and pleasant to the sight, and God says, don't eat. You know why? Listen. Listen very carefully. When we have relationship with God, even with relationship with other human beings, but especially when you want to have a relationship with God, listen very carefully. You have to develop unconditional trust. Unconditional trust. What did I say? Unconditional trust. What does that mean? It means this. Even though my sight, my hearing, my smell, my touch, all my senses are telling me that this is harmless. However, I am going to trust what God said. Even though it may not make any sense to me. God, listen, God put that test there in order to develop, what kind of relationship? Unconditional trust. Even though you don't understand it, you what? Trust him and obey exactly what he said. Is that important, yes or no? That's the reason why Eve fell. Because she didn't follow what God said. She followed her senses. What she thinks is okay. That's the first problem. That was the first problem. That's the beginning of the problem. She didn't trust God enough. Now, let me ask you something. Weekly cycle. First day, second day, third day, fourth day, fifth day, sixth day, seventh day, Sabbath, Saturday. Let me ask you something. According to your senses, scientifically speaking, seventh day very special? Scientifically speaking, based upon your sight, based upon what you can see, based upon what you can touch, are you telling me every Saturday is a special? Is it different? Are you understanding? Let me ask you this way. Are you saying, is there any scientific signs on Saturday that says that that day is very special? Do we have? Is there? Do we have any scientific proof? Every Saturday, do you think the sun shines brighter? Do you think sun shines brighter on Saturday? No. What, you think the birds sing with higher note on Saturday? You think cows, they lay down on Saturday? Huh? You think the air is a little more pure on Saturday? Is there any, like, scientific reason behind Saturday is really special? None. There is no scientific proof. There is none. If that is so, what makes Saturday special? Not based upon your senses, not based upon your reasonings, not based upon your, you know, your ideas, no. What makes Saturday special? Because what God said, period. Do you understand it? I mean, do you understand why God has chosen that Saturday? Only based upon He created everything on 6 days and He rested on the Sabbath day. But that Sabbath day is His choice, is His decision. What does that mean? When we follow Seventh-day Sabbath, what are we doing? We are saying, even though I don't understand it, I trust you because you told me. Because what you said, I trust you. And the question is, do you have that kind of trust? Or do you have to understand everything in order for you to follow Him? In the Bible, do we have Bible characters? Many times they follow God even though they don't understand. Are you following what I'm trying to say? So then, what is Sabbath? Sabbath has a few things going on. Sabbath, number one, always reminding you who is the Creator. Because every seventh day, you're reminded that God created heaven and earth 6 days and He rested on the Sabbath. And every time you keep Sabbath, now you can keep Sabbath in a very legalistic way, and that's not going to help you be a blessing to you. So don't keep Sabbath in a very legalistic way. But Sabbath should be a time for you to build, practice what? Unconditional trust that because He is a Creator, you just trust Him and follow His command. So the act of obeying Sabbath law, you are practicing unconditional trust. Even though it doesn't make easy sense. Even though in your mind, what's wrong with Monday? What's wrong with Wednesday? What's wrong with Friday? What's wrong with Sunday? Yeah, what's wrong, right? Nothing wrong. I mean, in common sense. But according to the Bible, God specifically said seventh day. And we cannot change that. And why do we follow? Because God is trying to build a relationship with us. And check this out. Sabbath is every seventh day. What does that mean? You, this practice of Sabbath keeping is a repetition. Every seventh day, you keep. Every seventh day, you keep. You repeat. You repeat. What does that mean? Repeat, repeat, repeat. You're building what? Habit. What kind of habit? Trusting in your Creator. Trusting in your Creator. And for some reason, my friends, in the last days, listen, in the last days, before the final destruction of the earth, God wants this Sabbath, the seal of the living God, to be in our forehead. Why? In the last days, we are going to see events that you cannot trust your own senses. You can only trust what God said. And Sabbath is like a preparation, is a place where you practice that implicit, that total committed trust in Him. That's one of the reasons why we keep Sabbath as and preparing ourselves to receive the seal of the living God. And the Bible says, 2 Corinthians 5:7, for we walk by what? Faith, not by? So that is a text that makes it very clear then we don't walk by sight. I mean, we should walk by sight, otherwise you will fall, right? But this text is saying we don't trust what we can sense. We trust what we can trust in the Word of God by faith, walk by faith. And then the Bible says, how are we saved? Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, it says, for by grace are ye saved through faith. And what is faith? Faith is something that you don't live by sight. So what does that mean, ladies and gentlemen? Let's put this in a very practical term. So some of you are thinking, huh, are you saying I have to keep Sabbath, no work? Oh man, so a burden. I know you may feel that way, but listen, it's a blessing because you're gonna learn to trust in God. I remember, I was working at a restaurant. This restaurant is called, it was a long time ago, Red Lobster, okay? It's called Red Lobsters. It was a long time ago, a long, long time ago. But anyhow, I was just learning to become a Christian, you know, it was the beginning days. Anyhow, here I am working, but then the manager keep asking me to work like Friday night, you know, Saturday time. But I am a young man, I need money, right? And my work is to earn tips, you know? I serve table and people give me tip. I need that money to survive as a student. But the managers keep asking me to work on Saturday. Now, maybe some of you are thinking, just work on Saturday, God understands. But when you say, God understands, where is a Bible text that says, you can work on Saturday, God understands? Hezekiah chapter 5, verse 7. Where's a Bible text like that? There's no Bible text like that. That's just your idea. I know, you may say, God is full of understanding. God is not that exact. Think about it. God, it's only a fruit. And the fruit of knowledge and good and evil, it's not poisonous. It's not like they bite and they go, oh, Eve, I'm dying. It was not like that. It was just a small thing. It was just eating a fruit. But God was so particular for that. So you may say, oh, just, no. But you may think it's unnecessary hardship not work on Saturday. You may think that way. But don't you get it? It's a challenge. And challenge is good. Why? It caused me to trust God even more. So I said, sir, I'm quitting. That's what I said. I cannot work. I'm quitting. I quit the job by faith. And like 1 week later, I got another job. Selling clothes. No more selling lobsters. Selling clothes. But that clothes shop, it's not so popular, so no customers. So praise God. You know what was I doing in the shop? Memorizing Bible texts. So I got paid for memorizing Bible texts. Isn't God good? Amen? I'm telling you. I know you're thinking, you just make it too complicated. It's really hard. Everybody works on Saturday. Why do you think everybody works on Saturday? Who made this world to be like this? Why is it that the best party night, Friday evening? Yet when Sabbath begins, why most people shop on Saturday? Don't you know the power of darkness behind the whole world? Don't you see? Satan is trying to cause people to forget God as a creator. And you might say, what about these Christians? They are sincere. They just worship Sunday. They still believe God is creator, but they go to church on Sunday. I know. You're sincere. And in many sense, you're innocent. But with your sincerity, with your, may I just humbly say, little bit of ignorance. But let me challenge you, with your sincerity, I challenge you not to stay in ignorance. If you are a sincere Christian, you want to find out exactly what the Bible says. Amen? And I know, I was a Catholic when I was young. Not a good one, because I didn't go to the confession. I felt too guilty to go. So I understand. I have attended other churches as well. And again, I'm not saying all Seventh-day Adventists are going to be saved. No. Because what it comes down to, only those who are truly following God according to His Word. So here's my challenge to all of you, even to Seventh-day Adventists. Because even Adventists, they can keep Sabbath, Saturday, very legalistic way. You know how? During Sabbath, this is what they do. When is sundown? When they ask the question, when is sundown? You know the motivation behind it? I cannot wait until Sabbath is over. Yes or no? Because I want to do something. I just heard at Robinson's, they're having 70% sales. It's only Saturday. And the sundown is at 6:30. But the store closed at 9 p.m. 2.5 hours of shopping, not enough. I know, you're calculating. Yeah, I know. Listen, even we can be really legalistic. But don't you know what Sabbath does? You know what Sabbath develops? Every time I enter into Sabbath, here's my mindset. Stop everything. It is a physical act of don't worry. Is that important, yes or no? When you're walking by faith, you have to really develop the attitude of, I put everything in God's hand. You may get fired, so what? You may not have customers coming, I don't care. Do you have that kind of a gut? Do you have that kind of mindset? Or you always want to compromise, conform, make sure your business is going good, and you donate to the church? I don't know what you're doing. But do you really have those faithful Christians that are mentioned in the Bible? They rather die than to compromise. So here's my challenge to you today. As we have studied all these things, as you can see, Sabbath, God's purpose, it was not for legalistic practice, no. Yes, it's a day. Yes, it's a Saturday. Starts from Friday night sundown and Saturday sundown. But what is purpose behind it? It's not like, okay, if you keep the Saturday very holy, no work, you go to heaven. No. If you keep the Sabbath very legalistic way, you're not going to be saved. You'll be lost. But do you still have to keep it? Yes. Then how do you keep it? You keep it with the heart. Every day you can work to earn for yourself. But on Saturday, you practice what? Practice, boom, stop everything. And only focus on God. Can you do this every day? No, you cannot. Some people say, we worship God every day. Yeah, sure. But do you give God one full day? Sunday, but what does the Bible say? Saturday. Why don't you follow that? Sunday is better. What does the Bible say? Saturday. So you really have to think about how much are you willing to follow God and develop this. I don't understand it. Why are you asking me not to work on Saturday? But Lord, that's what you said. That's what you want us. You want us to spend the whole day with you, helping other people, sharing the love of Christ to other people? Okay, I do. When I became Christian, my heart was, Lord, whatever you say, it doesn't matter. As long as it is clear from the Bible, I will follow. So let me ask you, tonight, do we have here anyone you're willing to open your heart, open your mind, and really learn to keep Sabbath the way that God intended? To develop that unconditional trust, faith, relationship with God? If you'd like to experience that and follow what the Bible says, please stand where you are. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you for standing. God bless you. Now I want to make a special appeal. And this appeal is to those, perhaps they're Adventists and some other denominations and other Christians. I want to invite all of you, Adventists and other denominations, no problem, but I want to invite you to this appeal, and that is this. If Sabbath has not been relationship-based day, if it was a legalistic day for you, but today you want to keep Sabbath, Saturday, in a very spiritual way, that you spend time with Jesus, spend time with God the whole day, helping other people, if that is your desire, and you have not done that, if that is your desire, I need you. I want you to come to the front. And there are some people here today, you never kept Sabbath before. Because you were keeping Sunday, or maybe not even Sunday. You just going to church whenever you can. But I want to challenge you guys. It's very simple. It's all about relationship, yes? And you cannot have relationship unless you develop systematic appointment with God, that God designed it. So I want to challenge you to follow what the Bible says. And if you're willing to follow the seventh day Sabbath, even to study it more, even to learn a little more about it, I want you to come to the front at this time. We want to have a special prayer with you. Anyone in the audience? Anyone in the audience that you want to experience God's Sabbath? Praise the Lord. Anyone else? God bless you. I know this is a hard, I understand, this is a really hard call for some of you. This is like, whoa, this is going to change my practice. Yeah, it will. But your thought is just very simple. What does the Bible say? You want to study more? No problem. If you'd like to study more, come to the front. God bless you, sister. Can you come closer here? God bless you. Anyone else? Praise the Lord, sister. Anyone else? God bless you, sister. Praise the Lord. Anyone else likes to join? Who shall be able to stand? Pretty amazing, huh? The Bible asks the question, who shall be able to stand? Who? Those that have the seal of the living God. And what is that? Seal that says God is a creator. Where is that found? Sabbath. So God is asking us to do this? Why? I know. So, sounds trivial, but that's how God tests us. In trivial things, as long as it is based on God's command. Come closer. Praise the Lord. Is there anyone else that wants to say, today, I really want to experience Sabbath? God bless you, sister. Anyone else? Blessings. I'm just going to give a little more time. Come. God bless you. Blessings to you. God bless you, brother. Is there anyone else in the audience? Blessings. God bless you. Anyone else? I want to experience Sabbath. Maybe you're saying, I'm not really ready to change the whole thing. Okay, I understand. What about just experience? Study it. Experience it. And let God speak to you. Because it's based on a very important question in the book of Revelation. Anyone else? God bless you. God bless you, sisters. Praise the Lord. Can you come closer to the front, to the center? Please come to the center. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Oh, look at this young man coming. Can you guys press closer? Don't be so shy. Come. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. Anyone else? Anyone else? The reason why I keep asking, because there are some people in the audience, when you go home, you're going to regret for not coming to the front. So I want to give you the opportunity to make that decision. And you might be thinking, why am I embarrassing you to, you know, make you to come to the front? Can you make your decision like where you're standing? You can. Can God see that you're making a decision? Yeah, He can see. Why am I asking you to come to the front? Because that will help you to be a little more bold about your personal decision and your desire. It's for your behalf, for your sake. I'm asking you to come to the front. Anyone else? God bless you. I know there's always a few more blessings. I want to experience the true Sabbath keeping. Yes, it's Saturday, but the deep spiritual experience. Blessings to you. Blessings to you. And please help me. Can you guys come right here in the front? Thank you. Thank you. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? God bless you. Praise the Lord. Now, if you don't make the decision tonight, you're done. That's not what I'm saying. Can you have more time to study it? Yes, you can. But I really want to invite you to let the Bible speak for itself. I know we had a blessing time all these different nights. But tonight is one of those nights that comes with challenge. Are you willing to follow what the Bible says? God bless you. God bless you. Blessings to you. Blessings. Just a last call for tonight. And I'm going to make more appeals following nights, but last call for tonight. God bless you, sisters. And I do want to mention, I don't want to make this so emotional. It is an emotional decision, but I want you to really think about it. I'm not playing like emotional music to cause you to come. No, I want you to come because you can see it. And you want to follow. Blessings to you. God bless you. And pastor, where is the pastor? Where is our pastor? Pastor. Pastor, could you, now, before you guys go back, among you, how many of you, Sabbath is like a totally a brand new idea tonight? Okay, anyone else? Yes, okay. You see those hands? Anyone else? Like Sabbath is like totally a brand new idea. Okay, there's some, okay, good. Our pastor will spend some time with you, okay? So he can follow up. Because if you'd like to have more Bible study, if you have more questions, he'll be able to answer. Yeah? What's that? Yeah. And could you just kind of, Pastor, could you come here? And he's going to linger right there. So Pastor, stay right there. And those of you who raise your hand saying that Sabbath is like totally brand new, you want to study a little more, please see the pastor after this prayer. Is that okay? Can you guys do that? Okay, thank you. Let us pray together. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the Bible. Sometimes the Bible gives us instructions that our human reasoning cannot fathom so easily. But then we do see the clear truth. We do see the thus saith the Lord. So tonight, with this very challenging message for all of us, help us, O Lord, to re-examine our life to see if we trust God unconditionally or not. Do we truly worship you as our creator? Do we truly follow you as one that has a power to create something out of nothing? Which means we can completely trust you that you can take a good care of us. And all we need to do is to follow your way according to the word. Tonight we have many young people and many people standing in the audience. They want to experience Sabbath, the spiritual and the literal, the day of Sabbath. And many, some of them are not familiar with this topic. I pray that through the study with the pastor, they will be led to understand the full understanding of Sabbath. And Father, we thank you so much for giving us this opportunity to study. May the love of Jesus continue to guide, that we may see the light and the truth will set us free. Thank you. Be with us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Before you go, I just want to mention to you, Jesus on the cross, that was that one moment for Jesus. He didn't understand what? He didn't understand why God was forsaking him. He knew he would be, but the feeling, he never felt that before. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? But even then, he didn't understand. He's willing to say, into your hands, meaning into the hands that are rejecting me, into your hands, I commit my spirit. So even Jesus on the cross, he showed to his Father unconditional trust. God bless you.